All right, if everyone's had their coffee, we can start on the final talk of this afternoon's session with Professor Sinai, also from Princeton University. Professor Sinai.
Yes, okay, thank you. So I would like to thank the organizing committee for the invitation to participate in this conference and to deliver the talk. I have several people who helped me in this. First one is Dong Lee, my co-author, with whom we wrote together something like 10 papers, and many of them will be used during this talk. Then my colleague from Princeton, Professor Nicolas Templier, who helped me with a translation into French several phrases which originally were in English. And then I would like to thank Carlo Bodrigini, who is here. And he worked together with his colleagues from University de Camerino, Friggio, and Maponi. And his results will be also just essential part of the talk. So maybe at the end, he will make several just additional comments. So let me say a few words which somehow can be considered as a continuation of discussion which we had yesterday after the talk by Professor Chaim Braziz. So I was surprised to hear about the months and the years of silence around the papers by Poincaré. So it was certainly not true if you consider the works of Poincaré in ergodic theory. Every textbook in ergodic theory began with Poincaré recurrence lemma, which contained not only the formulation but also the proof, belonged to Poincaré. And also just this surface, these sections of vector fields, which were proposed by Poincaré. This is very just useful tool, which allows to prove for vector fields several results, which are reduced to problems with discrete time. And actually, there were some extension of this result, which were proven by Ambrose and Kakutani, and they just constructed this Poincaré sections in the category of matter-preserving flows. So just I want to say that sometimes it is very difficult to interpret the events which happened something like 100 years ago. And let me give you just one example. Some of you probably know that Maxwell equations appeared in the United States 20 years later than they became known in Europe. The reason was the following. Maxwell was invited many times to the United States, and he was there with many visits, but he did not like his derivation of Maxwell equations. So all the time he gave talks on something like different subjects, statistical mechanics, optics, and all that. And then it took, as I said, 20 years of American scientists to understand the derivation and the meaning of Maxwell equation. So when we talk about the story of Poincaré, it might happen certainly that Poincaré visited Germany many times, but he just wanted to give a talk in the presence of Klein, and he thought that the most appropriate talk was about automorphic forms, just discrete groups, and all that. And it is quite possible that Hilbert even did not know that Poincaré worked on the Dirichlet problem. So now it is hard to understand, but this can explain the absence of references in the works of Hilbert. On the other hand, Poincaré considered himself as a very great mathematician, and the absence of just reference to his paper was a non-essential detail for him. At that time, there were no just citation index and all that, so it was not so important was his paper quoted or not. So now I just want to come closer to the subject of my talk. It concerns fluid dynamics, and presumably fluid dynamics was one of favorite topics of Poincaré. Actually, he gave just the theory of turbulence was in the list of lecture course which were given by Poincaré. And also he has just a book or booklet on the theory of vortices, which is also belongs to fluid dynamics. And therefore there are some reasons to believe that fluid dynamics was just one of his favorite fields. So the results and the methods which I shall discuss in my talk are concerned somehow with a Clay problem about the existence or non-existence theorems for Navier-Stokes system. And there are many people also in France who just proved remarkable results on this existence theorems in various spaces. Two-dimensional case was solved completely by Ladyzhinskaya. And as you know, recently there was a series of papers by Delalis and Shekelihidi where they constructed surprising just solutions of Euler equation. And it is not the set of problems which will be discussed in this talk. What I want to discuss is just connected with the quotation of Poincaré, especially with the second phrase, which is here. I'm sorry. Oh, does not work? I'm sorry. Maybe I must do it here. Can you see it now? No, but, okay. So, I shall discuss in this talk several problems which appeared from the analysis of nature. And the most notable example is just solutions of type of tornado. So tornado is just the solution for Navier-Stokes system where at some point of the space there appear very strong rotations having huge energy. For example, in Princeton, once a tornado appeared in the center of a big grove, and the result of tornado was that all trees fall down. The electricity broke down, and just many roads just were broken with this damage, and it took several days before everything was repaired. So, but we believe that the solution of equation of fluid dynamics, which is connected with this phenomena, is actually close to solutions which have blow up. So the energy is huge. And from just mathematical point of view, it is more natural to consider solutions with infinite amount of energy. So just we believe that such solution exists, and the problem of mathematician is to construct model or just study the cases when the solution actually do appear. We shall not consider the temperature, which sometimes is needed to analyze this problem. And this means that we shall consider a tornado of purely kinematic origin. So they just appear because of the property of just because of the motion, which is governed by equation of fluid dynamics. So now I want to go further to equations which we shall discuss in this talk. So actually, this equation can be written in the spaces of arbitrary dimension D. They are written here. From this, you see that the coefficient near Laplacian equals to 1. That means that the viscosity equals to 1. And then there is a pressure term minus the gradient of the pressure. And the second equation, just the gradient of U equals to 0, is incompressibility condition. Incompressibility condition means that if you consider vector field, which is created by moving just fluid, then it is just vector field preserves the Lebesgue measure. And just from another just side, it means that if we study this kind of dynamics, then there cannot be empty space without the fluid. So fluids fill all the volume which she can fill. Does everybody agree with this? Okay, good. So the next step will be to analyze, I'm sorry, we shall also consider a close relative of the equation, Navier-Stokes equation, which were written before, and which are called Burger's system, after the great just Holland physicist Burgers, who spent his last years in the United States. It differs from Navier-Stokes system by the absence of pressure and the absence of incompressibility condition. And some people believe that this Burger system is integrable. This is not true because integrability is valid only for solutions which are gradients of some function. In other words, if the vector u is a gradient of some function phi, then this representation is preserved in time, and for the potential phi, there is a simple equation. So what is just so what I'm explaining here is just called Hopf-Kohl just substitution, and in the space of gradient-like solution, the dynamics really is very simple. On the other hand, if we just consider just general solutions, which are not gradient-like, then they can be much more complicated. And later I shall show you some pictures from which you can see how complicated this solution can be. On the other hand, I want to mention that for Burger's system, there was a general theorem proven by just Russian mathematician Ladyzhinskaya, which just gives existence and uniqueness solution to the Burger's equation in some natural spaces. In other words, for Burger's equation, we don't have problems of just we don't have problems of constructing solutions on finite time. On the other hand, you will see that if we change a little bit the problem, then the situation will be absolutely different. So the method which I shall discuss in this talk is connected with which is called renormalization group methods. And this method appeared for the first time in quantum field theory and in statistical mechanics. And then sometime later, Mitchell Feigenbaum from New York just propose the application of this method to some problems in dynamics. And later, it just led to the appearance of the whole just new field in dynamics. And here are some names of people who worked in this field. In connection with this, I just want to make some remark that many people try to construct strange attractors for equations of fluid dynamics and even for Burgess equation. But actually, these attempts were not successful because we don't know so much about the structure of solutions of equations of fluid dynamics. On the other hand, you will see that there are questions and problems where this hyperbolicity, which is needed for analysis of this property, appears more or less automatically. This is just anticipate what we'll said later. So just first step will be to make Fourier transform for Navier-Stokes system. We make Fourier transform for the following reason. We want to study solutions which have singularities. If the solution has singularity, then it is not clear what are the derivative. It has to be specially defined, and this is some complication in general formulation. When we make Fourier transform, then this equation does not have just derivations, and it is just a sum of the first term, which is linear term, corresponding in some sense to viscosity, and then nonlinear term. The role of nonlinear term is to spread any information about initial condition over just the whole phase space in K space. And therefore, the meaning of this solution is the following, that it is the sum of linear term, which describes some damping, and nonlinear term, which just is responsible for just extend the solution to infinity. And the question is, who is winning in this process? And then I shall show to you that there are cases when nonlinearity is just stronger than linear term, and this is the class of solution which we shall discuss later. In this equation, there is just an operator P sub K, where P sub K is a projection to some space orthogonal to K for each K. And this equation in Fourier space is considered in the space of function V, which are orthogonal to K. Somehow, this assumption replaces incompressibility condition. So real valid solution of Fourier transform just corresponds to complex valued solution of the initial equation. And if we want to study a real valued solution, then it has the following difference compared to the usual equation. Namely, if we begin with equations of fluid real valued equations of fluid dynamics, then they always satisfy to the so-called energy inequality. Energy inequality means that if we consider the initial energy for our equation, then with time, this energy can only decrease. This is not true for Burgers' equation, but nevertheless, just for Burgers' equation, there do not appear any singularities. So what we shall do is was somehow inspired by Poincaré, and it is just now methods which was used in many cases. Namely, we shall consider one parameter families of initial condition, not a single solution, but just solution depending on the parameter A. A is a real number, and we just assume that V, initial condition is A times V of K0. And then we want to write down the expansion in this parameter A, and it is easy to see from the equation that one can write just a series with the powers of a parameter A, and it is just written here. So this is just this is just the linear term times A, and then there are other terms in this sum. The parameter P is greater than 1, and we have at least formal series whose coefficients are G of P of Ks. And this equation is equivalent to the initial Navier-Stokes equation, but for the coefficient G of P of Ks, we have a system of recurrent equations. So the recurrent relations are written here, and in principle, if we have just initial condition G1, we certainly can reproduce all coefficient G sub P. The first and the last term corresponds to somehow to the initial conditions. And the main part is just played by the sum over P1 plus P2 equals to P, and then rather complicated integral. It is a complicated integral, but nevertheless, I shall explain to you that it is possible to study this integral using some general remarks about the structure of recurrent equation. The main property is just the following. Assume that the initial condition is concentrated on a set C. Then it is easy to check that the support of the coefficient G sub K is just the set C plus C plus and so on plus C K times. And it just leads. I hope you didn't break it.
I hope I didn't break it. Either.
Yeah. So just it just means that in some sense the coefficient G sub K can be considered as K times convolution of initial coefficient J zero. If this is so, then we just choose initial number k0, introduce the vector k sub r, where only the last coordinate grows with r, and then consider normalized variable k near the point k sub r. And what is important is that it is normalized with the coefficient square root of r k0. So it is just the same normalization as in probability theory, and we can expect that in a typical situation, the values of y are numbers of order of one. They do not grow. Therefore, it shows how just the memory of initial condition spreads in the space k. So this is the picture. You see from this picture that in the vertical directions, the dependence on K grows linearly with R, but in the perpendicular directions, the dependence grows like square root of R. So this is the domain which has the corresponding form. And then another remark is that here one can make another just change of variables connected with the coefficients S1 and S2. I don't want to discuss it in more detail. It plays an important role, but later you will see a little bit of that in the formula. And so after all this change of variables, we come to the simplified recurrent equation, which is written here, and some of you might think that it is rather complicated equation. Actually, it is not, and it has many remarkable properties, and we can study the behavior of this equation as p tends to infinity. So actually, the answer is written here. If we just write our coefficients h in the form of two functions, h1 and h2, then for the limiting function, we have this recurrent equation. This recurrent equation is nothing else like Gauss, just equation for the Gaussian distribution, which is central in probability theory, or it is just the equation for the fixed point in renormalization group theory. And then the next step in the renormalization group theory is just to find the solutions to this equation. It actually turns out that this is possible. And then the result is just the following, that if we consider five parameters, sigma 1, sigma 2, h 1, 1, 2, h 2, 2, 1, and h 3, 0, 1, these are coefficients in the expansion of unknown function with respect to Hermite polynomials, then the solution are written in the form which is presented here, and this series converges well enough, so that the sum has that corresponding meaning. So we shall consider some very special solutions where C1, C2 are equal to 1. All other three coefficients are 0. And then in this case, the solution h of y takes a very simple form, which is written here, minus 2y1 and minus 2y2. And so what will be our next problem is to consider the linearized operator corresponding to the quadratic operator in the fixed point and to study its spectrum. This is also can be done in complete detail, and it turns out that the spectrum has four-dimensional subspace corresponding to four unstable eigenvectors. Unstable means that this eigenvector has absolute value greater than 1. Then six-dimensional subspace generated by six neutral eigenvalues, and then the remaining subspace of infinite codimension where the linear operator is stable. So now just it leads to the following picture, which just explains the structure of solution. And it says the following, that we denote by tau of u and tau of s, unstable and, just 1 second, u and zero, unstable and neutral subspaces, and then the remaining subspace, which is tau s. And then suppose that we have just 10-dimensional ten-dimensional submanifolds of initial condition. In this theory, we cannot have considered just a single solution. We must consider solution which has enough parameters, and then from general theory of renormalization group theory, it follows that there is a set of parameters for which the solution converges to G, and if you analyze the consequence of this assumption, then it exactly means that the energy of solution which we consider tends to infinity. And this is exactly blow up. So a remarkable thing of solutions which appear in this way is the statement about the growth of the energy. Namely, if we just denote by E of t, the energy of solution at time t, then at the point of that critical point, t critical, it grows like constant over t critical minus t to the power 5. This power 5 is universal in this theory. In other words, it's the same power for all systems of arbitrary dimension, and even just for other system than Navier-Stokes system. And just in the numerical studies, which were done by Carlo Bondrighini and his colleagues, this power 5 appear in excellent way, much better than all other numerical results. So this power, in a sense, is universal. The reason why it does not depend on the system is just connected with the structure of renormalization group theory, which we have here. Namely, if we just look at our results from the point of view of Fourier modes, of Fourier coefficients, then it turns out that we begin with initial conditions concentrated in a small ball. And due to nonlinearity, the modes corresponding to solution spread along one-dimensional line. And this one-dimensional line appears everywhere. And the fact that it is a line is connected with the asymptotic of the energy, which is presented here. It is certainly much stronger just growth than all just phenomenological theory of turbulence. But this kind of just singularity was confirmed very well. So now I just want to show you the results which were obtained by Carlo Bondrighini and his colleagues. And they considered the simplest case, namely two-dimensional Burger's equation without the external force. Just where it is. Here is the equation. And so here is the solution which they constructed. You see that time just goes down. And initially, the solution was more or less just normal. Then at some place, there appeared just bump. And then in another moment of time, there appear much bigger bump. And then there are all reasons to believe that if we follow along this solution a little bit more in time, then this bump will become infinite. So this is for solutions of Burger's equation, which we discussed before. And I just gave you the results which show that real valued solutions or gradient-like solutions do not have any just singularities. But if we consider complex valued solutions, then the singularity appear very well, and the growth of the energy in the solution satisfies to the inequality which I just explained before. Then also just Carlo Bondrighini and his colleagues just presented the solutions of the three-dimensional Navier-Stokes system, which are also complex valued solutions. This is a picture which corresponds to just hurricane Sandy, which just made so many just bad things in the United States recently. And then you can see that there are just some vortices which resemble very much vortices which corresponds to solutions which were just given in the previous picture. I shall say about this a little bit more. Then we come to another part of this talk, namely to the properties of bifurcations. I shall show you two pictures here. Just if I know how to switch it on. Here it is, one. I'm sorry, just, okay. No, that's, no, I'm not done. Here, yes, we consider the following question, which in a sense is model question for many other cases. And suppose that we have, just say, linear partial differential equations. And suppose that initial conditions are such that at some point, say at point zero, this initial condition has maximum, which is degenerate, meaning that if we write down the Taylor expansion of this function at t equal to zero, then this expansion begins from terms of the fourth degree. Then the question is, what will happen with solutions? So this picture corresponds to the case of heat equation, and there is a theorem which was proven by a student of Princeton University named Ben Schaeffer, in which he just showed that for the heat equation for any positive t, the point of maximum will be non-degenerate. So just heat equation is such that it just somehow destroys all degeneracy of solution. This equation, this picture corresponds to corresponds to biharmonic equation, so the derivative du over dt equals to minus delta u square. And then you see that from one maximum, there appear four just maxima, which exist for some time. And this is some kind of bifurcations, which is just quite interesting. And it would be just an interesting problem to investigate the number of singularities which appear from a given initial condition. So what is important in this case and why this picture is different from the usual theory of bifurcations? So as you know, bifurcations first were studied in the works of Poincaré on celestial mechanics. And he just used the various just expansion, various theories, in order to explain what happens with solutions of some kind. And there appeared the notion, which is called Virchow deformations. And Virchow deformations are just the families depending on depending on some parameter of system, which are in a sense universal. So the changes in solution which appear in Virchow deformation just appear more or less in all other cases. In the problem which we consider, this theory of bifurcations is changing. Namely, instead of Virchow deformations, we have solutions of our equations, our partial differential equation. So we just start with some initial conditions, and we just switched on the dynamics determined by the equation, and we want to know what is happening with solution. It turns out that the pictures which appear here can be just absolutely different and have just other properties. So here are just two examples which I mentioned, but then I just want to explain the other set of problems where we have this kind of bifurcations. Now, suppose that we write down the equation. No, it's not here. The fluid, so Navier-Stokes equation. And suppose that we write down this equation. Did I break something? No. Okay, good.
On the screen.
No, I just wanted. Yeah, I need this. Yeah. Okay, and how about this one? Uh-huh. Ah, yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, so we just write down the equation of fluid dynamics for the so-called stream functions. Stream functions, in many cases, are just more useful than the usual just components of velocity u, and they are connected with the velocity. So the velocity u is just perpendicular gradient of the stream function. Then just if we consider our system equations on the two-dimensional torus, then it is a periodic function. And as every periodic function, it has just maximum and minimum. If we want to reconstruct fluid dynamics trajectory, then near maximum and minimum, the trajectory of fluids are just directed along level sets of stream functions. Therefore, near this, near the extremal points, the trajectory are, in some approximation, closed curve. We call these sets as viscous vortices of fluid dynamics, viscous because they appear from the equation of Navier-Stokes, which has a viscosity. And they are vortices because near these points, the trajectory really just show behaves like vortices. And then I just showed you some time ago the picture of Hurricane Katrine. And in the center, you see the vortex, which was just appeared as a result of some bifurcations. And let me formulate some number of theorems which show what are the bifurcations, what kind of bifurcations can appear in these problems. These are not all the bifurcations which we know at the moment, but these are just the most natural ones. So the theorem one, which is, means the splitting of vortices, says the following. So suppose that initially, our just stream function, which is just more or less normal Morse function on the torus, has one maximum. Then we have Navier-Stokes system. So the question is, what is happening with this maximum under the action of dynamics? Then it is possible to show that the initial conditions in the left can be chosen so that at some moment of time, this maximum becomes degenerate. And then after it became degenerate, then there appear, instead of one vortices, appear three vortices. Two corresponds to maximum, one corresponds to minimum. We call this just bifurcations of young camel by the natural reason. And the theorem, which is here, says the following, that there exists an open set in the space of stream functions such that for each stream function in this open set, there is an open neighborhood in the time space in two moments of time, T1 and T2, so that for all this time T between 0 and T1, our stream function has only one just maximum, which corresponds to only one vortex. And then for t equals to t1, the stream function has two critical points. And this corresponds also just to vortices, but some of them, one of them corresponds to degeneracy. And for t greater than t1, the stream function has three critical vortices in u. So this is creation of vortices. If we just think about this as dynamics of atmospheres, then you can see that there can be evolution such that initially there was only one vortex, and then the dynamics was such that there appear several vortices. Another theorem of this type just gives the merging of the vortices. So when merging of the vortices, considering the merging of the vortices, we have initial picture when we have three critical points. Then at some moment of time, these vortices merge, and there appear one maximum or one vortex, which is just degenerate. And when time grows, this vortex becomes non-degenerate. So there is just big picture of vortices which can appear here. And certainly, they have some meaning for applications of fluid dynamics. And in particular, we think that they can be also used for creation of tornado and changes in the climate and all that. You know, I think just I spoke 45 minutes, therefore I can stop. Thank you very much.
Speaker has taken exactly 45 minutes, so that leaves us plenty of time for questions.
This is a young kind of application and not generic, right? Because generically, when you get two new critical points on slightly lower different levels.
No, this is generic bifurcations, because just initially we have just one non-degenerate.
Yeah, but not normally what you have. Normally you would have just like
yes.
And this is a degenerate bifurcation when you have all of them collapsed at once.
Yes. Yeah, they are certainly on a different level. I don't say that they are on the same level. So one can be higher than the other one.
No, but in this case, this degenerate maximum is it's something of order 4. Right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But normally you would have critical points.
No, in this case, cubic does not appear because the evolution just follows from Navier-Stokes system. It's not topological deformation.
Not possible.
No.
Code in Nirenberg, which says that singularities have zero measure in four dimensions.
This is just a different set of questions. It is just they have, so in the paper by Jessica Farrelly, Nirenberg and the other, just there was some estimate from above of just how the dimension of the set of singularity. Here we just describe the set of initial conditions, or the set in the functional spaces, where we can claim that locally the set of singularity consists of finitely many points. So it's not global results, but only local.
Questions? Does anyone want to take advantage of it? If not, let's thank Professor Steiner for his talk.